Hello everyone, welcome to Technology for Noobs. And in this video I would be going through ChromaDB again, but in a crash course mode. I felt the previous video was too long and I already have a notebook ready, and I will just walk you through with this code. And this would be a very small primer to know everything about the ChromaDB with their APIs. Okay, so let's get started. So once you have a ChromaDB installed, so that's pip install ChromaDB, that's very specific for the Python. And the very first way to create a database is very simple: import ChromaDB, then you want to create a client. ChromaDB has a client object, you just call it and you would have an instance running immediately. And once with the instance, now here is it's the Chroma client. You can start by creating a collection. So that happens through Chroma client dot create collection API and or module, anything you want to say it, dot create collection, and you got to give the name to it. So for this one, I have given my collection as the name. Once you have a collection, the very first thing which anybody would want to do is post some value into the collection, or here we can say it documents. So documents, so for that there is another API with the collection object dot add is the function for that. And when you do collection dot add, you have certain parameters which you can pass. So if you have to pass strings, that has to be inside the documents. This is very specific for the documents, right? So within document, it should be a list of strings however you want to give it, right? So it could be a one word also, it could be a sentence, it could be a paragraph, it doesn't matter. And the other thing which you want to provide is the IDs. So once you have given it, this will be saved. Now with that, once you have added some data to it, you can query that same collection. So the same collection objects needs to be created, or it should be there in your environment, and then only you would be able to do the query. So I will call my query, I will call my collection dot query, and in the query, as I can do a search based on the documents. So for now, if I have to do, it has to be inside query text parameter, and whatever value you want to search for. So it could be one word, many word, and how ChromaDB will search you that, it will try to find the nearest neighbor based on the word embeddings, and it will give you the result. So there could be many documents in it, so you can give an option, I want the top 2, top 3, top 10, and then it will give the output. So as you can see, I had only 2 documents inserted, and I'm asking it to query. So even if it is not related, there would be some value, a distance value, right, between the word vex of the document and your query text. So accordingly, it will fetch you. It doesn't mean it really has any meaning or not. It will just calculate the distance value and it will return you. So it is giving me the response. If you see here, it's giving me, I had asked 2 results. It has given both the documents. And if you see the distance value, one is 1.08 and 1.84. And accordingly, it has sorted the result. Now, if you look into carefully, this is query document about Hawaii. This was my query text. And what were the values which I had inserted? This is document about pineapple, document about orange, and some welcome to natural language processing. So if I update my query text with a fruit, if you see here, earlier it was Hawaii, now it is orange. If I do a search again, and now if you see the distance, now it becomes 0.58. Earlier it was 1.08 for with the Hawaii search, right? So accordingly, it has updated now. So the most relevant is coming at the top and the least is coming at the bottom. Okay, so now the next thing which is important is, whatever I did, if I restart my kernel, all will be lost. So how can I persist it? To persist the data, there is another class, chromadb.persistentClient, and you can pass the path db, and it will create a folder for you and it will start saving the collection there. So now my new object which I am creating is the client. The another important one is to check if your client is up or not. You just have to call heartbeat and it will return. int, that means it is running. Now the another API we have is the client.reset. What does it does it? It resets your entire client, meaning the DB, whatever collection you had created will be lost and whatnot. So it's a very admin related thing. And even to do it, if you simply do it, it would not work, right? So to enable this, I will just comment it out. So there are other settings which comes from chromadb.config. So there is a default tenant, default database settings. So in this particular setting, there are many things which we can provide. So what we are seeing, for example, default tenant, default database is if you have something hosted somewhere else, you can choose that. The default database for at present is the SQLite. You can change it to any other database kind of if it is installed in your system. But for now, I'm using the default database, that is SQLite. Now coming back to the settings, right, for the reset. So if you see here, now I'm creating a client but providing a different parameters to the persistent client. One is the path, another is the setting which I'm providing inside the setting class which I just imported. And what are the things I have provided here? Okay, which directory I can store, I want to store, whether it is persistent or not. So yes, I want to persist it, meaning save it, and then I'll allow reset. So meaning when I do a reset next time, it will just close it. And there is one more interesting anonymized telemetry which talks about, so this ChromaDB asks you to participate in their feedback kind of mechanism, where whatever queries you are running, they will go as a record, okay, this is what you have done, and they will take it as a learning or for training or creating a better product. So you can choose whether you want that or not, and mostly set it to false. And then this is how you create a new client, and now you can do reset, and as you can see, it's working. Now other APIs which are there is creating, inspecting and deleting collections. So because this also provide a HTTP client approach to launch a ChromaDB, so that's why there are certain nomenclature which you have to follow while creating a collection. So it's all mentioned here, you should not have any special characters, you must not, the name should not be any IP address, or it should not contains two consecutive dots, all those stuff, right? So this is just basic information. Then comes, okay, let's talk about, can I change the embeddings of the ChromaDB? So just to explain again, ChromaDB is a vector database storage where whatever text you have, it automatically calculates the embeddings and save it. And then whenever anybody queries as a query text, it checks the distance between the two embeddings, between the query and the documents inside, and returns the value. Right. So a user can be like, okay, I want to have a separate embedding function. So to do that, you have chromadb.utils import embedding functions, and within embedding functions there are a hell lot of other supported libraries. So ChromaDB already comes with a integration with other LLM model libraries like Google, Hugging Face, OpenAI and Amazon. So just to know, then you can have a sentence transformer embedding function where you can provide your own. It downloads the model, the base model which I am using right now is the all mini LM62. And once I have this embedding function, if I pass any strings, right here, if you see here, I will just do it again. I am passing a string and it will calculate the embeddings for it. So this is how the embeddings are calculated. And for now, the embedding which I have chosen returns a 384 embedding rate. Length of the embedding. So now if I have to create a collection, I have a API that says dot create collection with the name. Along with the name, you have to pass the embedding function which we just created. And now from now onwards, whatever document you will insert, the embeddings will be calculated using this new function. Then you can get the collection with the same name you have to pass. So if that collection already exists, you just need to do get collection, you don't need to create it, right? Because you are persisting the database. Then the another, if you want to delete, just simply say client.delete collection with the same name which you have created, and then it will delete it. So right now I've deleted my collection 2. If you are not sure, let's say you created somewhere many data points are inserted and now our documents are inserted, and then somewhere else you want to retrieve it but you are not sure whether it is there or not. So for that purpose they have a get or create collection. So it will search if the collection exists. It will not create, it will just have it as a get collection and done, right? So as you can see here, some collection I just created with the name some collection. Now the another functionality provided is you can rename a collection after creating it. So that would be like collection.modify and whatever name you have given, and it will update it. Now if you have to add documents, collection.add documents. Apart from that, you have another option that's called metadata. Metadata is nothing but if you want to store some other information apart from the just the documents, right? So that's how you can do it. So let's say you have some other information. Let's say you have a text, then you want to also store what category it belongs to or any such information, that you can store it here as a metadata. Similarly, just to reiterate, if you pass list of documents, it will automatically tokenize and embed it. If you pass an individual but within a list, it saves the one word, right? And the ID should always be unique. That has to be always maintained. And there is another information. See, if you want to calculate embeddings elsewhere, not using the functionality of the ChromaDB, then you have to pass the embeddings along with it. But just be mindful, whatever embeddings you will upload first, the same size of embedding should come always. That's how that is the only way you can have your collection, or you will not get any error value as a return, right? I am just putting some random data in my particular collection which I have just created. I am taking a random data which is FAS 20 news group. What I am doing is I am updating the documents like this, and in the metadata I am updating the length of that particular document. So that's how I will do it by using this code. Now once I prepared my data, and now I am just running it. So when I upload all those 100 records, I selected 100 records, it has created the embeddings and whatnot. Now there is another helpful function that says collection.peak, and you can choose how many collections you want to have or show, just like select query in our normal SQL database, right? So as you can see, it has all the information here. Okay, going back, get the number of documents in the collection. So how many documents are there? So 103, because I uploaded 103 from the previous. Now this is my collection with the new name. Define alternate distance function. So as I said, it returns the query text based on the distance, right? So you can define what type of calculation should be performed while computing the distance between two embeddings. So that you can provide you while creating the collection, and in the metadata you just say HNSW and space, and then whatever function you want to use, like cosine. The other supported one are the squared L2 and inner product. So for those, the short terms are L2 and IP. Then some more information on query the collection. So you can query the collection using the word embedding as well. You can also query the collection using metadata. You can also query the collections using a where document, where you can specifically say, okay, if the document has this particular value or not in it, right? Similarly, you can have query text where you can just put the text, right, what needs to be searched. Then you can also specifically say, when I am doing the get, I am interested on documents. So it will return you the documents only. Similarly, as I said earlier, you can do the search using the queries. Then if you want to filter based on the metadata, it's a very straightforward, whatever metadata you have, and it would fall under the where parameter here, right? I was showing here. See, where would do the filtering of the metadata, where document will do the filtering on the documents. So these are the supporting operators, equal to, not equal to, greater than, and then there are some operators as well like and or. So logical operator. So if you have to pass again in the where clause, you can just simply say and then whatever metadata you want to have there. Then you can also do a update operation that is very specific with the ID. And even if you try it and you have passed a same ID, whatever corresponding to it will get updated. And there is another functionality called upsert, meaning you try to find a particular ID, if that exists, you update, if you don't find it, you insert. Simple. And then the another one is where deleting the data from a collection. So you can, while deleting the entire collection is also possible, and then deleting a particular document based on a particular condition is also possible. That happens using collection.delete. And then whatever condition you want to pass should be in where or where document or embedding or ID. Good. I believe this is all, but this is not completely all, but this is the most of the time used ChromaDB APIs. And that's all for this particular video. If you like my contents, please consider liking my channel or liking this video and subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much. Have a great day. And happy learning.